good morning. Thanks for the introduction. It's a pleasure to me to be here today. Well, during these last days, we have listened in several talks that there is a genetic component in Chiari Malformation type 1. But what do we know about this genetic component in Chiari? Well, honestly, we don't know so much. Today I'm going to present, I'm going to summarize the genetics works that has been performed in Chiari Malformation type 1, and I'm going to show you the work that we are working currently. And I hope that you will see how difficult it is to identify the genetic variant in Chiari Malformation type 1. Well, when we talk on a disease, the first question that we have is, what produced that disease? Well, there are some diseases that are produced only because there is a genetic variant, there is an alteration, a mutation, are diseases that usually are produced by rare genetic variants that are not common in the general population. And usually to have this genetic variant produce a very easy phenotype. It's the case of diseases such as hemophilia or the Huntington disease. But there are also diseases that has been produced because of external factors, such as the virus or bacteria, is like flu or the chickenpox. But there are also diseases that are produced by the combination of genetic and environmental factors. Are diseases like diabetes, heart disease, most of the cancers. Diseases that are produced by the combination of several genetic variants that usually are common in the general population. And as I said, it's a combination of genetics and environmental component. So the fact to have the genetic variant doesn't mean that you are going to develop the disease. You need another factor to start to develop the symptoms. Where is Chiari Malformation type 1? Well, as you will see after in the presentation, currently we think it's a complex disease where there is a genetic component with an additional environmental component. Why we think there is a genetic component in Chiari Malformation type 1? Well, first, as you have seen in other talks, there are some families with two or more affected members in the same or different generations. There are additionally twin studies in which there is a major concordance in the monozygotic twins respect to the dizygotic twins. And as you have seen also in other talks, Chiari Malformation type 1 often is presented with another genetic disorders. Genetic disorders that are rare, they follow the Mendelian inheritance and are disorders that are involved with, are related with bone anomalies, with alterations in the skin pigmentation or with the hormones. Well, when we study the genetics in a disease, the studies can be focused in study the DNA, the code of the genome, but we can also focus the studies at the level of the RNA, that are the transcripts, are the expression of the genes, or also at the level of the proteins. The most of the studies that have been performed in Chiari Malformation type 1 are focused in the DNA. You can also focus studies only in sporadic cases. This kind of studies try to identify the genetic variants that gives the susceptibility to develop the disease. That studies consist in compare common genetic variants between two cohorts, patient cohort and control cohorts. Following this strategy, there is only one study performing Chiari Malformation type 1. And that study, Is the cable? No. Okay. Following this strategy, there is only one study that has been performed in chiral malformation Taiwan. In that study, 384 SNPs were analyzed, corresponding to 58 different candidate genes related with the paraxial, mesoderm, the desmoids and the occipital bone development, and also related with some of the genetic disorders that are related with chiral malformation type 1, such as neurofibromatosis type 1. In that study, we only analyzed those patients who presented a reduced posterior cranial fossa in order to try to only analyze a homogeneous group. In that study, we identified four different genetic variants that were associated with chiral malformation type 1. They were located in three different genes, and the genes that are in the genetic variants that are located in the gene ALDH1A2 were also correlated with the slope of the clivus. But however, we cannot explain exactly well how they played a role in chiral malformation type 1. When you perform genetics studies, you can also focus the studies only in familial cases. In that case, the main goal is try to identify the genetic variant who produced the disease. The most of the studies that has been performed in chiral malformation type 1 are focused on familial cases. So one of the strategies is to perform a linkage analysis. That strategy tries to identify a common region in the genome that are shared with all the affected members in the family, but is not in non-affected members, and assumes that contains the genetic variant that is going to produce the disease. Well, following this strategy, the first study that has been published analyzed 23 different families that contains in total 21 affected individuals. They analyzed 10,000 SNPs, and what they found was two interesting regions, two significant regions in two different chromosomes, chromosome 9, chromosome 15. And specifically in the chromosome 15 was really interesting because contained the gene, the fibrillin 1, that this gene is also related with other genetic disorders that are related with Chiari, such as Marfan syndrome. Some years ago, another study was performed following a similar strategy. In that case, they analyzed 66 families, but the strategy was a little bit different because in that case, they didn't analyze all the families together. They stratified according if they presented or not features related with the connective tissue disorders. In that case, they analyzed more than 500,000 SNPs, it's a lot. And what they found is in the families with the connective tissue disorders, there were two interesting or significant regions in two different chromosomes, chromosome 8, chromosome 12. They were also interesting because they contain the growth different factors, the 3 and 6, that they are also related with genetic disorders that are related with chiral malformation type 1, that is the Klippel-Feil syndrome. They went a little bit further, and they wanted to see if there was a genetic variant, a mutation, in any of these ones in the families that they found this candidate region. And from all the families, in only two, they identify a genetic variant, but in only one of them, you see here, this member of the family is not unaffected, but she presented the alteration. So they conclude that this gene can be related with chiral malformation type 1, at least in some families, and probably doesn't have a complete penetrance. So that gives more strength to the idea that chiral malformation type 1 probably is a complex disease. Okay. As I said at the beginning, you can also focus the studies at the level of RNA to compare the gene expression of the genes. There are a couple of studies performed following this strategy in chiral malformation type 1. One of them was published a couple of years ago, was focused in 44 pediatric cases cases that had to go to the surgery. So in the surgery, there were recruited samples from two different tissues, dura and blood. These samples were recruited thanks to Dr. Grant. And more than 11,000 genes expression were analyzed. And what we identified is there were some genes that were up and down regulated. Some genes are different from dura, genes from different in blood. The thing is, no one of these genes are really directly related with the bone development. So there are some evidences, but they couldn't conclude in something specific. Recently, we have performed another study focused on the gene expression. This time, we analyzed the osteoblast. Osteoblasts are cells that are on the bone. We recruit samples from two patients and one control. We know that the size of the samples is really small, is really reduced. But well, we can obtain some preliminary results. And what we saw is there were 361 genes that presented a different level of expression. Here I only show you the five top more upregulated and the fourth type downregulated. But again, no one of these genes are directly related with the bone development. So we cannot conclude anything in specifically. Now I'm going to show you one of the studies that we started in Barcelona 8 years ago. We are still working on that. But well, everything started because a patient came to the hospital. She was a woman, she was 35 years old. She presented a big tonsil herniation. She didn't present syringomyelia, neither hydrocephalus, but she presented neurofibromatosis type 1. I don't know if you are familiarized with this genetic disorder, but patients are characterized because they present caffeolate spots on the skin, they also present neurofibromatomas, some of them scoliosis, bone defects, and also optic gliomas. Neurofibromatosis type 1 is a genetic disorder that is produced because a partial or a complete deletion of the gene, the NF1, that is located in the chromosome 17, is a disorder that follows an autosomal dominant inheritance, and almost 5% of the KRI type 1 patients present also neurofibromatosis type 1. Well, when we asked to this patient if some other members of the family presented KRI malformation type 1 or neurofibromatosis type 1, she said, no one of them present neurofibromatosis type 1, but all my siblings present KRI malformation type 1, my daughter too, my nephew too, so you can see some of the MRIs. What about your father or your extended family, member families? Well, some uncles presented also Chiari malformation type 1, but his father, who also presented symptoms, as you see, there is absence of tonsil herniation. And for the uncles, the tonsil herniation is moderate, it's not as big how it is in the second generation. So maybe we are talking about in a family that contains Chiari 0, Chiari 1 patients. It's not the same. It's not the first time that we see that. There is a paper that has published some years ago in which there are some families that there is Chiari 0, Chiari 1 in alternate generations. So that means that probably Chiari 0, Chiari 1 share the same component genetic component. And well, that family was really interesting because in total there were 12 affected members in three different generations, and it seems that follow an autosomal dominant inheritance. So what we did was we performed a linkage analysis, tried to identify a common region in the genome, but our strategy was only to analyze this family, not include more families, because maybe there are more genes involved in this disease, different genes in different families. So at the end, to try to find a common region in the chromosome between all the families is not possible. So we analyzed 6,000 SNPs and with 8 microsatellites, and the analysis was following the idea that it's an autosomal dominant inheritance with an incomplete penetrance. And we identify an interesting region and a significant region in the chromosome 17. So again, assuming that it's an incomplete penetrance, we are saying that it's a complex disease. So it's not only a genetic component, it's also an environmental component. Well, this region is really, really interesting. It's huge, contains more than 300 genes. But some of these genes are related with the paraxial mesoderm development, with the occipital development. But there are also genes that are related with other genetic disorders related with Chiari malformation type 1, such NF1, that is neurofibromatosis type 1, or the GH1, that is the growth hormone. So, well, we thought, yeah, this is the region, we have the genes. The problem, 300 genes, it's too much. It means a lot of work, a lot of money, and we're talking about, that was 6 years ago. 6 years ago, we didn't have the technology that we have currently, so it was impossible to us to analyze the 300 genes. So, well, we wait 1 year, and then the new technology appeared. And this technology, what it does is sequence the genome. But you can choose to sequence the whole genome, sequence all the variants. You are going to identify the, all the genetic variants that you have different. Or you are going, or you can sequence only the coding regions, so the exon parts. So that regions are the regions that are going to codify for the proteins. Until now, it has been thought that it's that produced the disease. So what we chose was to perform the whole exome sequencing, because in that moment, more than 85% of the non-mutations for rare Mendelian disorders occur in the exome, and because of the price, of course. So what we did, we selected two individuals. One is, was the case index, and one of her cousins with Chiari malformation type 1. So we performed the whole exome sequencing, and we had more than 600,000 variants for each individual. So, wow, which one is the variant who produces Chiari malformation? So we started to filter the variants to filter according to some criteria. The first criteria was to select only those variants that are in heterozygosis. So, okay, we obtained until 20,000 variants. It's much less than 600,000. But we also selected the variants who has not described previously in other public databases, and the variants that were in common between the two affected members. Again, we identified 57 common variants with this criteria, but it's a lot, 57. So we thought, okay, we have the data from the linkage analysis, so maybe we can try to see if some of these variants can co-segregate well in the family. So let's see if we can reduce more the number of the variants. And yes, only 4 of them seem to co-segregate well the family. One of them was in the candidate region in the chromosome 17. And then we went to validate these variants to see if they were a real variant. The gene that it's DDX52, that is the gene that it was in the chromosome 17, in the region that we were interested, both of the variants in each individual were false positive. So yeah, we had to discard this, this variant. So okay, we have 3 more, no problem. But when we validated and we saw how co-segregate these variants with the family, no one of them co-segregate at 100% with the phenotype. As you see, there are 2 affected members who don't contain, who doesn't have the genetic variant. So we also discard these genetic variants as a causative of Chiari malformation type 1. Okay, what we did more? We thought, okay, We can sequence more individuals and try to reduce the genetic variance since the beginning. And in this time, we are going to also sequence one individual that is non-affected in order to try to discern the variability of the genes. And we also select a second family, a family with 5 affected members, and we sequence 4 of them. We follow another pipeline for in order to filter the variants. And well, from the first family, as we have 6 individuals, we identify only 25 variants that pass all the filters, so it's much better, 25. And from the second family, there were 357 variants. Again, no one of these variants were directly related with the bone development. So, okay, maybe the genetic variant that we are looking for is not directly related with the bone development. Maybe our approach is wrong. Maybe we need to search for something that is more deep. But how to filter the variants, where to start? Well, the first thing is try to see if there is any variant or any gene that are common between the two families. And there were 3 genes in common between the two families. Are the FM2, the MUXIN4, and the pseudogene. We need to validate these variants. But again, as they are not related with the bone development, we cannot discard the rest of the variants. So what we did was to compare with the previous studies to see if any of the variants match with the previous results. So from these 3 variants that are in common between the two families, what we saw is the FN2 was also presented at different expression level in the osteoblast. And the MUSIN4 present a different expression level in the dura tissue. So from these 3 variants, 2 of them seems to be really, really interesting or involved in chiari malformation type 1. But we need to validate that. Regarding to the rest of the variants from the family 1, there are some of them that were different expressed in blood tissue, some of them that were different expressed in dura, only one in osteoblast, but no one of them were in the linkage region. But what is interesting from here is that there are 2 variants that is different expressed in different tissues. So it's in one family, but different expression in different tissues in other patients, that seems really promising. From the second family, again, there are some genetic variants that are different expressed in blood, in dura, in osteoblast, some of them also in some interesting candidate regions in the chromosomes, but 2 of them presented different expression in different tissues. So they are also a very interesting genetic variant for chiari malformation type 1. We are currently in that point. So until that point, what we can conclude is that chiari malformation type 1 is a heterogeneous disease. A good characterization of the patients is essential in order to identify the genetic component involved in the etiology. After performing a linkage analysis and the whole exome sequencing in a large family with 12 chiari type 1 affected patients, no evident genetic variant was identified. That could be because the genetic variant is not in the coding region. Also because it's a complex disease and then there is an environmental factor, but more than one genetic variant involved. The comparison between the whole exome sequencing analysis performing 2 chiari patients, chiari families, sorry, identified genetic variants located in 3 common genes, and the integration of the whole exome sequencing analysis performing 2 chiari families and previous independent studies identified common genes. So next steps. The next step is try to validate these genetic variants with Sanger sequencing to try to see if they are really true, they are not false positive, and then to see if they co-segregate well with the families. If these variants are rejected, then go again to the rest of the genetic variants that we identify and select according to the role that they play or to select another criteria and perform the same, validate and see if they co-segregate well. If we identify some of the genetic variants that are validated and co-segregate well, then see if there are other familial cases that also present the same genetic variant. And the last step is demonstrate that this genetic variant is that produced carrier malformation type 1. And to perform that is performing functional analysis using animal models. But, well, this is a further step. There is a lot of work to do, hard work. So I hope next year to present something else, another step, and, well, we will see. And okay, this work is a very hard work. It's a long work that has been performed thanks to all these people, experts in carrier malformation type 1, genetics, bioinformatics, and also thanks to the funding resources such La Marató de TV3, Instituto de Salud Carlos III, and La Fundación Ramón Areces. Thanks for your attention.
Hello, doctor. Thank you. Hi. I think it's a two-part question. Mm-hmm. So, pretty basic question. The first part is, have you or any of your research fellows considered looking into the telomeres?
Telomeres?
Yes.
Well, we don't discard in the genetic approaches when we search for the whole genome, even in the linkage or the sequencing, you can see all the genome, telomeres, everything, the centromeres, everything. So we don't discard.
And the second part is, it's just a general question, and you may not have an answer. Do you have an opinion on whether or not the action of, like, say, for instance, a cancer tumor turning on the telomere repairing gene? Do you think that might have a correlation with any of the research here?
With carrier malformation type 1 or about the mechanism?
Just with including the telomeres in your sequencing.
Okay.
Do you think there'd be a correlation?
It's a good question. Yeah, I cannot answer you.
Okay.
I cannot answer you.
No, sorry, it's kind of, I tried to figure it out in my head how to phrase it. I'm probably not phrasing it correctly.
Okay, no, it's fine.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay. Questions? Okay, no more questions?
Is 12 people in the family the biggest that we know of in the world, basically? Because I thought my family was doing pretty well at 7 people, and now I find there's another family that's...
Well, we have several families. I think when I finished my PhD in Barcelona, there were like 24, 25 families with several affected members. I think 4 or 5 presented more than 4 affected members. And one, I think there were 7 affected members. So there are families. And honestly, I think there are more families that we have identified because, you know, until now, the MRI didn't exist. So only with the symptoms, was diagnosed in with other disorders. So I think there are a lot of families that they have the symptoms, but they don't realize that they have carrier malformation type 1. So I think there are more families with more affected members that until now we have described or identified. So it's not a rare case.
Okay.